the words are a little different, but they all convey sort of the same thing, that you always had my back, you always loved me as I was, you know, you didn't compare me to my sister or my brother. And they, I think each kid always felt like they were the favorite. And so, parents, listen to what I'm saying. Your words make a difference.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, we have the privilege of speaking with many parenting experts every year, and I especially love conversations with advice you can apply starting today. You don't need a degree. We received some wonderful feedback on this broadcast from parents who felt like they were at the end of their rope and needed some practical help. I can remember times when my boys were young and I felt like Gene and I were stuck in a frustrating cycle. No matter how many times we reminded the boys, say please, say thank you, it seemed not to stick.
Well, and I just want to observe, Jim, that it did stick because they are really great young men. They do say please and thank you and yes, sir, and
they've
yes,
gotten
ma'am.
Better with age.
Well, if this is your situation, then stay tuned because we have some wonderful common sense advice for you today.
And we're revisiting a conversation that we had with Dr. Kevin Leman, and my wife, Jean, joined us as well.
Yeah, it's always fun to have her here. And this was one of our best of conversations based on Dr. Kevin Lehman's great book, Why Your Kids Misbehave and What to Do About It. Let's go ahead and revisit this Best of 2021 episode.
John, we have a little studio audience with us, some Focus staff people. Let's say hi, everybody.
Hi.
And we're going to have a little Q&A at the end here.
We will.
And so be thinking of your questions as we move along. Also, you said Gene is here. Gene, it's great to have you here as always. Dr. Kevin Leman, great to have you both. Thanks for being with us.
Oh, yes. We're a winning combination.
Well, I know that. You guys, I'm a little concerned, actually.
Well, last time we were together, we talked about marriage.
I know. Right? Yes. And it's really helped in Gene and I's relationship.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, she called me.
There have been times when I've come home and said, you know, Gene, I think we need to spend 15 minutes and let the kids go play. And she'll say, who did you interview with today?
That's true.
And so I could say, well, Dr. Kevin Leman had that great idea. Yeah. But you've worked with lots of families, Kevin, and you have noticed the ways kids work their parents. Now, I've never experienced that. Have you, John?
Oh, golly.
So speak to that issue about how kids work their parents. And I think you had a specific example about being in a restaurant and seeing a little a little one work her parents.
Oh, my goodness. You know, I've often said we've seen the enemy and they are small. You know, and they're unionized little suckers. And they have a game plan. And we were at one of those commercial steakhouses and in Tucson, where I live most of the year. And a young family came in. It was mom, dad, maybe 12, 13-month-old little child, grandma, grandpa, and maybe an aunt. And they were in one of those round booths, but right next to us. I'm an observer of people, let's put it that way. And I just thought to myself, oh, this is going to be interesting, because they brought over one of those little wooden high chairs.
Right.
In fact, you've seen people maybe turn them upside down in a restaurant, and they'll put a car seat in.
Yeah.
Yes.
And the dad tried to put the little cherub into the seat. And instinctively, the little cherub pulled up her legs. Okay.
Going to make this hard.
And that's when I said, I'm going to pay attention because I know how this is going to play out. And God bless them, they tried to get that little ankle biter in there, but she had no part of it. So what do? Dad goes and brings her and puts him on the seat. And I knew that child would be passed around, which happened during the meal, came back to Dad. Dad was trying to feed the baby. The baby took a spoonful offering and threw it over the shoulder. I mean, it was just hysterical, but it reminded me of one of the things I try to share with young parents, and that is don't start habits that you don't want to have continue throughout your child's college graduate years. In other words, There is something to training. There is something to making, if you will. Making. I mean, you're training, if you'd prefer that word. But training children that you will sit in that high chair. Okay? And it's a test of wills. And don't think these little guys don't have a will of their own.
Right. Well, let me ask you about that. So what would be the appropriate way that that mom and dad should have handled that?
Put them in the high chair.
Period.
Put them in the high chair.
Even if you have to kind of spend some time working those ankles in there.
The basic premise is kids will live up the expectations we give them.
Hmm.
Now, if you're a young parent today and your goal is to create a happy child, we should all bow our heads and pray for you now. Because it's going to be disastrous. If that's your goal, to create a happy child, there's times the kids need to feel unhappy, experience unhappiness because of their mouth, their attitude, whatever. And so take time for training. It's like if you have a puppy, when do you start the training? Do you wait till the puppy is 6 months old or a year old? If you do, you'll have a miserable dog on your hands. So you really have to take the time for training. And anytime it's a public event, like we started off the discussion about trying to get this little ankle biter into a high chair, but anytime there's a public audience, the child knows that. They have little built-in antennae that says there's an audience. So if it's in church or it's the pastor's son or daughter or whatever, I mean, they got you.
Yeah, they do.
Yes.
Over the barrel.
Kevin, you mentioned in the book transformation. That's a good goal. Uh-huh. What do you mean by transformation? And especially, obviously, with our children, what is that moment of transformation? What does it look like?
It's a process. You know, I often said that parenting isn't easy. I'll give you that. But it is simple. It's simple. What do you mean it's simple? Well, there's a paradigm that works. And it puts you in authority over your children without being the authoritarian. Without being the permissive parent. And of course, today, most parents come in two basic types. The authoritarian, you're going to do it my way. It's how most of us in this room grew up, in authoritarian homes.
Right.
But the permissives are out there in huge numbers today. And they're just knocking themselves out, trying to make sure their kid is happy at every turn. But in terms of transformation, as kids grow, I mean, Steve Covey once said, start with the end in mind. It's a great thought. You're creating really a little adult. And not that we want kids at a young age to perform like little adults. I don't mean that. But you work toward the end of maturity. And we give kids responsibility. And so many of us are rule conscious. We believe that rules are the way to rear children. Rules are not the way to rear children.
Let me jump in on that. I want to get Gene in here. Transformation, that's something I think you would agree, the boys, we've seen that in our own parenting. Describe that and then talk about kind of the rules issue that Kevin's mentioning.
Well, yes, I say to parents, be of good cheer because you're strong, passionate, as Dr. Leman says, power-driven child will probably turn out to be a delightful young person, a productive member of society.
Not a car thief.
Correct. Correct. And I've seen that in our home that, our oldest son, who is strong and passionate, is a delightful young person.
Now, is this the child that you practiced on, by the way?
Yes!
Well, transformation is the key there. He has turned a great corner.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, there's many factors, but I think two main factors are I was the authoritarian parent, and rules were important, and respect was important, and parents, you cannot discipline your children enough to respect you. They will respect you less. You cannot force them to respect you. And I learned that too late, but I finally let go and stopped trying to control our oldest child. And he responded beautifully. It was a process, but I needed to be treating him as a future adult.
See, the opposite of fear is what? I think it's love. Love and fear. So those of us who control, okay, we fear that somehow we're going to lose control. And, you know, when I think about adults I've dealt with in life, I've never had a woman say to me, you know what I really love about my husband? I love the way he controls me. I've never heard that.
Right.
And so the transformation, I mean, sometimes this little guy is 3-4 years old and the preschool teacher has become your best friend because she's calling all the time telling you about the activities that little Timothy got into today. Well, you might have that discussion as husband and wife and say, you know, there's time for a transformation. It comes across as, okay, now hear this. Starting tomorrow morning at 0800, this family is going to change. and a lot of us, when we make that announcement, we just revert back to more authoritarian, strong-arm tactics rather than really try to get behind the eyes of this little guy.
You know, before we move beyond the rules orientation, Kevin, there is a natural bias in the Christian community. We want to live up to expectations as Christians. We, in essence, subscribe to a set of boundaries that we're going to live by, etc. So rules aren't necessarily a terrible thing, but it's how you treat them, right? The Pharisees, I mean, the biblical example is Jesus blew the Pharisees up in terms of, hey, it's not about the rules, it's about the heart. But elaborate, because I think Christian parents, we tend to want to, how many of us have family rules?
Oh, yeah.
And we put it on the wall. And
We do have family rules, and you teach kids that when you come to a street, you look both ways. I'm reminded of the flat cat who got hit. No, really, it was flat.
Yeah, I bet it was.
Poor little guy ran out in the street, and he got hit by a truck. He was pretty flat. And everybody was devastated, but the lesson was, you know, little Chucky would be alive today if he would have looked both ways. And so as a parent, sometimes you use those natural things in life to show kids why there's rules in life. Rules are healthy, okay, if they're presented, like Jim says, you know, in a positive, good way. We all need rules. But the point is, as kids grow older, I made the point in my book, our kids never had a curfew, ever. They never had a curfew. And people look at me like I got a screw loose.
Well, only Gene and I.
And the kids would always say, they would say, what time do I need to be home? And I was always come back with the same answer. Be home at a reasonable hour. Dad, would you just tell me? They don't like that answer. They want the rule.
Yeah.
What were you achieving by doing that? What were you teaching them?
I'm teaching them that I believe in them, that they have a good brain in their head, and they're going to use good judgment.
And generally, they came home earlier than you thought they should.
Oh, yeah. And if they were going to be late, they were on the phone with a long list of explanations about why, well, the football game was in overtime and the bus was late and, you know, whatever it was. And they just want to reassure they're going to be okay and not in the doghouse. I said, honey, enjoy your pizza. Come on home. It's okay.
One of the things we never did, and I wish we would have, is have a family motto. And Kevin, you spent some time in the book talking about family mottos and how that kind of imprints us and how we kind of lead and parent that same way we grew up.
Oh.
One of yours is pretty obvious, and Jim shares this one. It's let's have fun. Talk about that a little bit.
It's a last born thing, right?
Yeah, what is the family motto of let's have fun lead us to be it, like as parents?
Yeah, it can get us in trouble once in a while, that's for sure. Yeah, you have to understand that you took away as a youngster a mantra about life. Those mantras are things like, I only count in life when I have fun, when I'm the center of attention, when I get people to do what I ask them to do. Now, there's your typical baby, the family. They are social. They can be fun. They're whimsical. They change from moment to moment. They could sell dead rats for a living. I have an early childhood memory of selling bags of dirt in sandwich bags, door to door, for 10 cents a bag.
And people bought it.
Yeah, and they were silver dimes back in those days, I want you to know. People bought them. But, you know, So you grow up with that, and now you're a daddy, and my wife remembers me taking little Holly, our little Holly Dolly, we called her, our firstborn, and I would say, little Holly's flying through the air, and I'd throw her in the air like a lot of dads do, and I'd get her up at about 8 feet. My wife was done. I mean, it's like we got this fun thing, and it walks, and it wets, and it does all kinds of things, you know. And thank God I married the firstborn who had rules, okay? And she was a good balancer for me, so our kids actually ended up in a pretty healthy environment.
They never got seriously injured.
But when I shouldn't admit this, but when I drove our youngest, Lauren, to school in the morning, we have five kids, okay? I'm driving little Lauren, she's in seventh grade, to school. And we had different things that we would do. And she always had a little girlfriend. I picked up a little girlfriend with her in seventh grade, and I'd drive them to school. And we had little handicap driver day. And on the way to the school, we would go through this residential area where the speed limit was 25 to begin with. But all of a sudden, I would crouch down, okay, in my little car, and I'd get down to about 7 miles an hour. I'd check to make sure nobody's behind me. And then I would just creep through the neighborhood. And when a car came, then I would always wave to the car. But I would raise my hand so slowly that I really never flashed the wave till after the car went by. And these two seventh graders...
Were they squealing with delight?
Die laughing. Then we had special delivery day, where I literally came into the parking lot. They have a flat sidewalk approach. And that's why I say I shouldn't say this on the air. I would drive right up to the door. I was 6 feet from the door and let the kids out. And they were, and of course, the other kids, I became known as, I was very popular on the campus. Let's just
Crazy dad.
Crazy
maybe?
Dad, thank you. I'm glad you said that.
Just popped into my head.
Yeah.
You know, we did crazy fun things. Would Mrs. Uppington, my bride, ever do that? No. There are rules. You just don't do things like that.
And I would like to add that God puts men and women together who are unlike each other, who are different, and we're often
generally
opposite.
Yeah.
Yes. Right. And now in hindsight, I appreciate those differences in parenting. It's really important. It's
wait a second.
Good
wait a second. Say it again. Say it again.
I really appreciate you, Jim, as a father. The fun.
He was the fun dad.
Well,
but he was the good guy, the fun guy. You were Attila the Hun that came across with all these things.
Absolutely. Oh yes. Yes.
But you know, we learn from each other.
Well, that's true.
And I've learned that I need to grow up, to put it bluntly.
I'm with you there.
Life isn't always a party, you know. And I tell some of these stories, and I get a few Pharisee letters because I tell those kind of stories, because somehow people think that I ought to be up on some kind of pedestal. No, if anybody who knows me, I'm not a pedestal person.
Kevin, one of the things you point out in the book is that we as parents can inadvertently kind of pave the way for our kids to misbehave. I think it's a really important point. So how do we do that?
We train them to misbehave.
But be specific.
Well,
I mean,
when you go in a supermarket or a store, mommy's, I'll pick on you. What's the conversation with your kids?
I want that.
Huh?
I want that.
That's the first thing. So what does the parent say? All right, listen up. We're going in the store. Don't ask for a thing, because the answer is no.
Wait, have you had a recorder in my van?
Oh, yeah, but that's what we do. Well, what have we just said to the kids? And no running around, no fooling around, and don't ask for any candy.
Say it again, just so they can hear you.
Yeah. Well,
say it louder.
What happens is you've just said, I really don't trust you. You're going to misbehave. Mm-hmm. And what do the kids do? They misbehave, and they're in a public place, and you're the one. I mean, people will look at your kids and shake their head, but they're looking at you as a parent and say, boy, that parent, not a good job, parent.
Okay, so what's the right way to do that?
Well, I think you take advantage of situations where the kids are very well behaved and very respectful. And just a simple comment that, you know, I got to tell you, that was really fun today. It was really fun to be with you guys. And I got to tell you, I'm proud to be your mom. I'm proud to be your dad. Mm. You know, I look around sometimes, I see how other kids behave. I just got to tell you, I call it slipping your kid a commercial announcement. And you have to slip those messages to kids. And the kids walk away with, guess what? Mom and dad believe in me. And that's really important that a son or daughter feels like you have their back. I was in our summer cottage this past week back in New York State, and I was going through pictures, and I found all the Father's Day cards. They make me cry to this day. No. But I look at what the kids have said, you know, and they just, the words are a little different, but they all convey sort of the same thing, that you always had my back, you always loved me as I was, you know, you didn't compare me to my sister or my brother, and I think each kid always felt like they were the favorite. And so, parents, listen to what I'm saying. Your words make a difference. Those words of encouragement that you give to your kids, that's that indelible imprint. Those two big boys of yours, Gene, I got news for you. I know they're big like your husband, but they have your indelible imprint on them as a mom. And every young man needs a good dose of, guess what, femininity.
Yes.
Every young daughter needs a good dose of, guess what, masculinity. So it's that cross-sexual relationship between a daddy and a daughter, a mother and a son, that are the building blocks to make that kid a real healthy human being.
Yeah, and it's so good, and our boys love their mom.
This book really speaks to why kids misbehave. Well, why do kids misbehave? Number one, they're attention getters. All kids are attention getters. You know, they come out of the womb, they're completely dependent upon us, and as they grow into infancy toward that year old, you begin to see this little spirit. You begin to see this little personality develop. I always tell mommies of young kids, when that child hits 18 months, circle the calendar, because you're going to see a test of will start about 18 months in a child's life.
Well, and you elaborate on that, because you say both good behavior and bad behavior is both a yell for attention.
Absolutely. So again, I go back to, all kids are attention getters. Just follow me for a second. So if the kid gets positive attention for positive behavior, they're on the right track. As soon as they don't get positive attention, they still need attention, so what kind of attention are they going to get? They're going to get negative attention. And the kid tells himself, well, I'm still getting attention. It's still working. But that runs its course. So as the kid gets more discouraged in life, believe it or not, I'm saying a little ankle biter, 18 months to 3 years old, can get discouraged. Life isn't working out the way they think, even at that age. They become powerful. So why the attention getter says, I only count life when I'm noticed and I put people in my service, the powerful kid says, I only count life when I control, when I win, when I dominate. So these are the kids who throw temper tantrums. And how we respond to those temper tantrums is really important, because that kid throws the temper tantrum for a purpose. Now, purpose is just a word. Purposeful is a psychological word that comes from the psychology of a guy named Alfred Adler. We won't go into any detail there, but let's just say that all social behavior serves a purpose in a kid's life. So the powerful child is saying, I am in authority over you, parent. There's a guy named St. Paul who said something very different. He said, children, obey your parents. It's the right thing to do, because God has placed them in authority over you. And I love that translation. That's a Living Bible translation. And that's what I try to preach to parents. You need to be in authority without being the authoritarian to deal with this powerful child, because you need to remove your sails from that child's wind. Because if you don't, and you come on with, you can, I am your father, or they're going to blow you right against the wall.
Yeah.
In a power struggle, you lose. So you need to develop ways of circumventing that powerful child. where they realize that, wait a minute, these powerful ways aren't working. These parents are a little smarter than what I'm giving them credit for.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's the obvious question. When you have that confrontation, what should you do with that three-year-old?
Yeah.
Well, you pick up the child, remove him from the scene. That's the principle I want to teach. And it just says, hey, it's not going to work.
Yeah. Kevin, let me pick up on that, because in the book you do describe a parent's responsibility to make sure their child is getting enough of your time. That could be so difficult. And we can, as parents with busy schedules, we can justify all of our busyness. But you're saying in the book, your child needs you and needs you to spend time with them. So sometimes this misbehavior is rooted just in they're not getting enough of you.
Well, let's start with this anti-American statement. Activities are not good for your children.
Now, let me ask Jean, does that cut against the mom feeling of keeping the kids busy
yes.
is a good thing?
It does.
Busy hands are happy hands.
Right.
Well, and even, you know, I felt when our kids were young, I did not want them to spend too much time in sports. And I recognized that that wasn't positive. And putting that pressure on them at such a young age. However, as they got older, I wasn't sure that was the right decision.
Well, now we have team soccer. We have city soccer. The whole weekend is geared around the kids' soccer or softball or whatever. I'm telling you, it's crazy. Kids, families don't go to church on Sunday because they're off playing in a softball tournament. Again, it's all, so much is just directed toward the children. That we bring up kids to feel like they're the centerpiece of the world. I've said it many times, and I'll say it again. If you do that, where is the room for Almighty God in a kid's life? Mm-hmm. And I'm here to answer my own question. There's no room for God in that kid's life because you got them so busy, and you're so busy. So when we talk about time, where's the time? The dinner table is a great time to talk, but other than that, I mean, and I've heard on Focus on the Family studies from other authors who said dads will spend 37 seconds a day talking to their kids, things like that. It's outrageous.
Yeah, it is. You're right.
Kevin, back to Jim's point, I do remember a time when our oldest was, I think, 7 or 8, and he just was consistently misbehaving. It was kind of uncharacteristic. And, Jim, you've heard me share this story before. I actually talked to one of our counselors here at Focus on the Family, and we met with her, and she dismissed me and talked to our son for a little bit and then brought me back in, and she said, well, Dad, I think he's really just wanting you. You're really, really busy, and he's feeling like he's not getting you. So I think there are times, don't you think, when kids do misbehave, and it really is just
cry for help.
You know what? I'm just not pouring in like I can.
So what's the purpose of nature of a child, 8 or 9 years old, misbehaving? My point would be, well, he's probably an attention getter. To wit, he needs more time with you.
Couldn't verbalize it, though.
Sometimes kids are powerful. Sometimes kids are revengeful.
Hmm.
Our prisons are full of people who grew up feeling hurt by life. And things happen to those kids should have never happened to a kid. But they did happen. There was no rescue plan. No one came alongside of them. No one brought them to Christ. You know, they just went off on their own. And their whole thing is being vengeful toward other people. They're hateful toward other people. Well, the world they grew up in was hurtful. So if you had a kid grow up in Fantasy World USA, and in Fantasy World everybody was kind, there wasn't a thief in town, and then you brought him to Thiefville, where everybody is a thief, that kid would be shell-shocked. You know, that kid would run back. Now, let's reverse it. Bring up a kid in Thiefville where everybody's dishonest, and now bring him to Fantasy World where everybody is honest. How's that kid going to behave? If they see a watch in a restroom that was left, what are they going to do with that watch? They're going to stick it in their pocket. Why? Because that's what they grew up with. So the mantra, that imprinting, whatever you want to call it, in this book, I call it the three basic. There's four, but the fourth one you don't see very often. So we'll deal with the three. Attention getting, power, and revenge are mostly the motivation behind the poor behavior, the maladaptive behavior that you see in your home with your children. But you need to understand that message that the kids are feeling like they need more parent. They need more love. They need more acceptance. And that's the art of being a parent, is making that kid feel special.
Hmm. No, that's a good way to look at it, and that's part of what you've included in your book there. Kevin, you're known as the birth order guy, and some people may not be familiar with that, believe it or not.
Really?
How many millions have you sold of that book?
Many trees died in its honor.
And it's a great concept. It's one of those, you know, rare thoughts that you were able to grab and put into a book, the birth order book. But just lightly tell us how that functions and how that helps to shape who we are. I'm sure we're not locked into that, but you generally learn certain behavior patterns depending upon where you are in the pecking order of your birth, right?
Well, firstborns are the movers and shakers in our society. There are leaders, there are political leaders, there are senators, our congresspeople, there are presidents of the United States, there are astronauts in outer space. If there's something technical, the engineers, the accountants, you're going to see an inordinate number of firstborn and onlyborn children. They're sort of psychological cousins to each other. They do very well in life. The child right beneath them is a disadvantage. If that child's a middle child, they're going to end up a mediator, a negotiator, a compromiser. They're going to be good at seeing life from both sides of the fence, which is pretty good. I love to tell middle children of the peanut butter and jelly of the sandwich. The babies of the family, if you name a comedian right now, in all probability you're talking about a baby of the family. Just name one. They're babies across the board. Very few exceptions. Mm-hmm. All the late night TV guys, I don't think they're very funny, quite frankly, but they're all youngest children.
Why is that? What action is in play there that makes them predominantly come from?
The achiever role was filled by you firstborn children, okay? The next child in line is the opposite of that firstborn. Mm-hmm. So there's two roles, whatever they are. So that baby, the family, is that humor guy. He can't compete, and that was true of my life. I couldn't compete with my sister and brother, so I became the best of the worst. I graduated fourth in my class in high school from the bottom. I mean, I was taking consumers mathematics, that's bonehead math, as a senior in high school. I couldn't get it in college. I finally did get in college on probation. I mean, most of you know my story. I mean, it was terrible. But you know, along came this woman when I was 19 years old after I was thrown out of college, and she was the one, my future wife, who I met in a men's room of a hospital, believe it or not. She was the one that God used to turn my whole life around, and God gave me motivation. And I'm thankful for those years I struggled. But we are a product of our environment. And you as a parent, you've taken whatever you glean from mom and dad into that role of parenthood. It can work for you, but it can also work against you.
So what do we do knowing this and its predictability? Because that's what's genius about it. It's generally true. It may not be absolutely true in every case, but I think you've done enough research and talked to enough people that you understand it the way you do. But how does a parent help augment that firstborn child to actually maybe not be as uptight or rules oriented, et cetera? Do you want to do that? Or is this just the way God has planned it? And this is why kings and princes tend to be firstborns and leaders, as you said. Is it wrong to create a leader out of a lastborn?
Well, I tried and failed to, with my firstborn daughter, I tried not to make her a firstborn. I'm here to tell you, I failed. She is a firstborn. She was an English teacher. She knew what a dangling participle was.
I mentioned so high that. Achiever.
Huh?
High achiever.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, so do you just roll with it? I mean, is there a reason to try to augment that or just let it go?
For all you firstborn and onlyborn children listening to our broadcast today, you know you might have a tad bit of perfectionism in your life. And perfectionism is slow suicide. That's what you have to understand. And I think the smart parent, when the kids are little and you're tucking them in, and this is the kid who's got to line up everything, you know, everything's got to be just sort of perfect. Kids love stories. Tell them stories. Make up stories. Embellish stories about your life. Share with them about the time you were embarrassed in school, about the time you got picked on, about the time you failed, whatever it is. Let the kids see the imperfect nature of you. I spoke in a church just 3 weeks ago, and I gave a talk on the title of my book, The Way of the Wise, which is Proverbs 3, verses 1 through 6. I gave a very simple altar call about the imperfection of all of us. We had over 100 people respond. I mean, I was sort of shaking my head. I was taken back, but how many people responded to that? We're all imperfect.
That's right.
We need each other. Kids need to understand that we have their back. We love them with all their flaws. To our school teachers that I have some influence over, and we're talking about a fourth grade spelling test, why would you write minus 4 at the top of that? What's wrong with plus 96?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What's wrong with looking for the positive ways of expressing, hey, good job? Good job is what I think I call vitamin E. It's encouragement. Mm-hmm. We're not praise. Praise God. All others pay cash, as someone once said. God's worthy of our praise. Your kid isn't. But your kid needs encouragement. Encouragement says, I got your back. I see how you're doing life. I'm proud to be your parent. You're doing good. And if you get stuck, I'm here to help you. Hmm. If that message comes across to your son or daughter, they're going to go out in life and they're going to be a winner.
In the book, you describe discipline 101. And in there, you said discipline goes hand in hand with misbehavior. So what's the difference between discipline and punishment?
Mm-hmm. Well, see, and this is sort of framed in our society today, because if you just come across as I'm punishing you, let me tell you how a kid thinks today. They don't think of us on a different plane. They see themselves as social equals. So in their head, okay, if you're a right to punish me, I have a right to punish you back. And discipline, I think, takes on a little different color, that we acknowledge that mistakes were made. We turn things into teachable moments. You know, I love to tell a story about our high school invited me to be on their wall of fame, and I jumped at the opportunity to do it because I was such a little cut up in high school. But on the way up, I was talking to my mother, who was 90 years old at the time, and I said, Mom, we fooled a few people. You know, oh, honey, I'm so proud of you. And I reminded her about the time the police brought me home. I'll never forget what she said. She said, oh, I do remember that, but you are such a good boy. And so somehow we still have to come across with the fact that, you know, we love you anyway, and we accept you flaws and all. So discipline is, hey, you take the kid behind the closed door, and you have a little talk, and you give them the look, and they get the message that what happened at dinner or what happened at school was not cool at all. And my expectation for you is that we see a change in your behavior.
Mm.
It's a teachable moment. And you ask the kid, what are you going to do to change that? We talked about rules afterward. All the Leman children wrote rules governing the use of the family car. I didn't give them the rules. They wrote the rules. I didn't ask them to write the rules. How'd that happen? They must have assumed that they realized it was a privilege to have that key to that car. You give a key to a car to a kid that's not responsible, that's on you. You're a dummy parent. Don't do that. Have expectations for your kids that are reasonable, yeah, not unreasonable.
And what I continually hear from you, Kevin, is put that on your child to give you the boundaries. I mean, you're pretty consistent with that. Mm-hmm. I like that idea, although it's a nail-biter for some parents, especially firstborn parents.
Yes, but it helps. It just helps reinforce the goal. Are you raising a child, or are you trying to raise an adult?
Again, that's a gold star observation.
Kevin, let me ask you this. Yeah. Parents, we can emotionally overreact, obviously. Mm. And I think it's really critical as we wind down the time. We're going to take some questions in a minute. But one of the things that we trip on as parents is that we can get sucked into the emotional argument. And we end up, I mean, I did this with the boys when they were younger. I mean, I'd be right down at their level emotionally. I'm going, oh my goodness, who's the adult in the room?
Yeah.
You know, and the question I have for you is just, how do we as the parent remember we're the parent, mm-hmm, and don't be, you know, tricked getting into that game with your kid.
Don't take the bait.
Don't take the bait. Well, remember, fighting is an act of cooperation. When you fight with your husband or your wife, you know exactly what to say to escalate the battle, okay? Same thing is true of kids. When kids fight, they know exactly what to say to escalate the battle. And furthermore, they know how to engage you in the battle. You need to stay out of that battle. So you don't react, you respond. And you're authentic. And you learn to say things like, I'm sure you can handle it. Turn your back and walk out of the room. If you see blood 20 minutes later, I'd get involved. But let the kids have a track record, so to speak, in their own home that they're going to solve their own problems. And so I would say don't panic. Don't overreact. Be a listener and listen again. If you can listen without judgment, if you remember this, judgments will separate you from your child. Judgments will separate you from your husband or your wife.
What's a judgment sound like?
You're wrong. Prescriptive. You know.
Where, you should have done that kind of thing.
Yeah. Anything along that line. So if you learn to listen without judgment, okay, just hear them out. Lots of times the situation will calm down by itself. So we make things worse. It's like we throw kerosene on the fire. It just flames up.
Yeah.
But just remember, fighting's an act of cooperation. And some people are listening right now saying, boy, my kids sure cooperate.
Right.
Because they fight over everything.
Right.
Well, if you have a trouble getting a kid out the door to school, and maybe you're in a carpool. In fact, I have that example in this book. You want that to change? I can tell you how to change. It'll change in one day. Leave your 11-year-old home. Don't call him. Don't get him up in the morning. Take the other kids to school. He'll be waiting there in the carport. He'll be out in front of the house. He'll be mad. He'll be angry. He's late for school. Honey, we've had this talk so many times. I'm not your alarm clock anymore. From now on, you're either up, you're on the train, or you're not. And I'm not real happy because now I have to drive you back to school. But be smart. Send an email or call the principal. Have them call that kid in and talk with him about being late. It works beautifully. Action, not words. You've already used words. You use them every day, over and over and over again. It hasn't got you the results. You want the kid to be up in the morning and on the school bus? Use action, not words. That's why the little Why Kids Misbehave is such a good practical book. Because the back part of it is what to do about it. And those are some of the things you do about it.
Yeah, and you have a whole host of time-tested strategies in there, Kevin. And it's a great resource. But let's open it up now. Let's have a couple of questions from our guests here today and see if they can stump the expert.
Dr. Leman, I'm Tammy Devine. I have a question about entertainment choices. You know, I drive myself crazy sometimes going, no, that music is all about sex and drugs. That TV show, even though it's a children's show, is all about bad messaging. You know, those games are too violent. So where is the balance and where's the line that parents can have between being too permissive and, you know, being too strict when it comes to our kids' entertainment choices?
That's a divine question.
Oh, no. Good job.
Well, let's start with screen time. Okay, we've just come through the pandemic. I'm here to tell you there's hard research that says that screen time is not good for children, period. Any kind of screen time. Computer time, watching television, video games, it's not good for kids. It dulls their senses. So activities for kids, young kids, that involve playing with boxes that you get at the supermarket are great activities for young children. Most of what we see on TV is pretty worthless, to put it bluntly. Well, what's a parent to do? Well, number one, your role as a parent, Tammy, is not to entertain. Use the term entertain. Your goal, your job, is not to entertain your children, ever. That's not your job. Mommy, I have nothing to do. Okay. Oh, you need something to do? Oh, I got a lot of things you can do. We can start. You want to start in the garage?
Yes, let's start in the garage.
You're pretty good at toilets, aren't you? You're our toilet cleaner. I mean, the kids will learn real quickly. Don't come and do that dog and pony show. Kids will find their own. You know, kids who used to play. Now parents today, we used to play naturally. We'd get on bikes and disappear, and the rule was in the family, you'd be home before dark. Well, now today in America, I mean, that is the farthest thing from any parent's mind. You arrange play dates, but kids need socialization. And so it's a smart parent who gets kids hooked up with other kids and let them invent the playtime. It doesn't have to be electronic. And I think the more you move in that direction, parent, the better off your kids are going to be. Avoid the screen time as best you can. Is it a part and parcel to America? It is. You mommies, you live life on the cell phone. I call it the new Goliath. And I'm here to tell you, we're not going to defeat this little puppy. When you want to go to a movie, I know what you do. I watch my adult children. They can do anything on that phone. And by the way, they say that, Dad, you should not own a phone. They said straight out, I shouldn't own a phone. I can't remember a password. I get in more trouble.
I'm old. You're in good company.
So anyway, yes. I probably talked too much on that answer, Tammy, but it's hard to make choices. But, you know, as your kids grow older, some of that stuff that's not so great for them, you're going to stand back and you're going to let them figure out if that's a good decision for them or not. That's the hard part.
That is the hard part. That's good. Okay, another question. Go ahead and just state your name. And
I'm Troy. I feel like I'm kind of interpreting two different messages. One is, like you were sharing at the restaurant, you got to put them in the high chair. And then another side is, we parents can focus too much on the rules or being too strict on things. I'm curious what that balance is practically when I'm in the restaurant. Where do I bend? Where do I not?
I hope you're hearing balance, because it is a balanced attack. Mm-hmm. Using a sport analogy, you can have a great offense, but if there's not a defense, you're not going to do well. And that's the art of parenting. It's knowing when to throw that flag. It's knowing when to say, hey, time out. You don't talk to your mother like that. You don't talk to me like that. And it's action, not words. We use too many words with kids in parenting. We need more action. Sometimes you take the little buzzard by the beak, so to speak, or you pull a rug out and let the little buzzard tumble, as I like to say, and it's sort of shocky. You sort of blindside them. Honey, I don't feel like getting you a glass of milk right now. I don't feel like driving you to your girlfriend's house right now. Let them figure out what's wrong. Let them come around and say, is something wrong? Actually, honey, there's several things wrong. Are you ready to discuss them? Yeah. I didn't like the way you talked to me this morning. Now, there's your balance. I mean, Jesus told us to turn the other cheek. Okay? So do we go through life turning the cheek with people? If you look at Jesus' life, he was a man of action. He saw the money changers in the temple. He didn't turn the other cheek. He took action. And so that's the job of all of us as parents, to be able to discern, how far do I let this child go? What are our parameters? Remember, don't confuse bridles with bits. Many times as parents, you know, we want to just control everything. And you just have to back off. Let kids figure out these boundaries here in the families. They pretty much know what mom and dad's expectations are. You don't have to remind them 1,000 times, like Jim shared earlier about, say please, say please, say please, say please. They get it. Don't you think the kids are saying after about the 16th time, what do you think, I'm stupid? You didn't think I heard the first 15 times you told me to say please? I got it, Dad. But we're creatures of habit. But if you want to connect with kids, you need to have a balanced attack. And that would be my message back to you, is you are hearing two messages. That there's times you take the buzzard by the beak and you make things happen. There's other times you let them figure it out that this isn't going to work out really good, and you sit back and you're almost laissez-faire, almost permissive to a point where they they're in trouble, and now they need help, then it becomes a teachable moment.
Mm. Hi, Dr. Leman. My name is Evan. You talked about the importance of training children, and like with a puppy, starting when they're young. For those of us who may not have done well at that when they're young, is there hope for us? And how might we, say, with elementary school children, start to be more intentional about that training without causing a shock to the family?
Well, I love your question, Evan, but I think one of the real joys of parenting sometimes is blindsiding those little suckers.
It's a spiritual truth, right?
It really gets their attention. And see, you have the heart of a parent. You're saying, hey, Leman, okay, I'm with you. I understand, you know, maybe you got a kid still sleeping in your bed, for example. And Dr. Leman says, don't start habits. You don't want to have continue forever. So get that little sucker out of bed. And you're saying, well, I'm looking at my life and, you know, there's some things that we need to change. But how can I change them without being injurious to little Buford? And I'm saying, no, Evan, let's try it a different way. Let's blindside that little sucker, Evan, and really get his attention. And then say, you know something? Mommy and Daddy have done some real heart searching. And we think that things have to change here in the family. And you're going to see some changes in us that you're probably not going to like, because we're all creatures of habit. We've all learned to do things a certain way, but there's some things happening soon. You're going to see that. And you're going to have to deal with it as best you can. Now, I prefer that over trying to make this a soft, easy transformation into a new world for that son or daughter.
Dr. Leman, my name is Shawnee. I was just visiting my sister and her husband and their two kids in Minnesota this past weekend. The oldest is almost six, and he has a younger sister who's two. And he's very much a typical firstborn, and he's gotten lots of attention from his parents over the years and extended family. And what I noticed this weekend is not unusual from previous visits, but there's moments throughout the day where he's having great times, and then he'll just have an absolute meltdown. He'll say, I'm not having fun. You know, it's all about him and how he's not constantly entertained or things aren't going his way. And later that evening, I just remember seeing, especially my brother-in-law, really just disheartened and discouraged. And so my question for you is, how would you encourage them? Because they are trying some things, they're working on some actions, but they're really frustrated because his attitude absolutely drains them every day.
Oh, great question and observation. A couple of things for you to pass back one way or another. How you pass that back to him is up to you. That takes some skill to pass this kind of information along. Number one, I would make a conscious effort to stop trying to make that six-year-old happy. That six-year-old can be as unhappy as he or she would like to be, in my opinion. You also have to realize that 4 years ago, the thing came home from the hospital. That would be the intruder.
The competition.
Yes.
So for 4 years, this little king reigned, okay? And mommy and daddy, proud parents, did everything they could to make sure this kid was happy, happy. They've given this kid things. And my observation with giving kids things is they have a voracious appetite that never ends. And they want more things. And I've said many times, there's nothing worse than watching a kid on a Christmas morning go through gift after gift, just ripping them open one after another, just wait, and no acknowledgement of someone's hard work or money or thought that went into giving a kid's gift. Kids are selfish, self-absorbed little suckers today, and it's our fault as parents because we've placated them, we've given them things. The things the kids need today are love, acceptance, discipline, belief in them, and they need instruction. They need instruction in faith, what love's all about, what God's all about, what family life's all about, and most kids, quite frankly, don't get it. Because we're driven today as parents to make sure these kids are happy, happy, happy. Every place I go, I'm still speaking in churches all around America. And I can guarantee you that one of the first things I will hear from someone is, we're so glad you're here, Dr. Leman, because we want happy, happy, happy children. I emphasize that is not the goal of being a parent, to create a happy child, but a responsible one. You want responsibility? Give responsibility to kids. Hold them accountable. Don't be impressed with their antics. They're con artists, okay? They'll play you like a violin.
Kevin, this has been so good. And Gene, always good to have you here. Your great book, Why Your Kids Misbehave and What to Do About It. We barely covered the subject, and you've already given us so many great insights. Dr. Leman is so much fun, and I think it's obvious why this is one of our most popular programs this year. We highly recommend you get a copy of Dr. Lehman's book, Why Your Kids Misbehave and What to Do About It. And if you can send a gift of any amount today to Focus on the Family, we'll send you Dr. Lehman's book as our way of saying thank you.
Donate today and get your copy of Why Your Kids Misbehave and What to Do About It. The link is on your screen, or call 800, the letter A and the word family. 800-232-6459. While you're at our website, you'll find a free assessment called The 7 Traits of Effective Parenting, which will give you an idea of where your strengths are as a mom or a dad, and maybe some areas you can target for growth as well. You'll find all the details by clicking the link on your screen or giving us a call. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team here, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.